Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak in this seminar. So Hofer-Zehnder capacity and local systems and this is based on joint work with Peter Albers and Urs Fraunfelder. So I want to explain some recent progress related to Hofer-Zehnder capacity for cotangent bundles, for compact neighborhoods of the zero section inside cotangent bundles. But there's a little story that that goes behind, and I will start with a little story. And the fact is that the Hofer-Zehnder capacity is one of the oldest symplectic invariants. And by symplectic invariant, I mean the following. You take a symplectic manifold, possibly with boundary, right? And it associates to it one number, which may be infinite. And this has some remarkable properties, which are monotonicity, namely that if you have an embedding of manifolds, symplectic manifolds of the same dimension, right, symplectic embedding, then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity cannot decrease. Then something called conformality which says the following, that if we look at the capacity of a manifold for which we have rescaled the symplectic form, we see that factor coming out. And in particular, this tells us that the capacity is radically different from the volume, say. Yeah? It's also related to the symplectic area. It's something of a two-dimensional nature. And also normalization which is the fact that for the ball of radius 1, it's equal to pi. And that is also the same value as for the ball of radius 1, but in dimension 2, times R2n minus 2. And here, I consider the product symplectic form. Right? So it's definitely not something related to the volume. The simple fact that for such a function, you have monotonicity and normalization immediately implies conformality immediately implies the Gromov non-squeezing theorem. And as a matter of fact, the existence of a capacity implies generally the C0 closure of the group of symplectomorphisms inside the group of volume preserving diffeomorphisms. So it's really like it's pretty remarkable that in a quantity that's just one real number, there's really the core of symplectic geometry that's hidden. So this particular capacity is perhaps significant. There's many such, yeah? But this one is particularly significant from a dynamical point of view because of the following striking existence theorem. So assume that for some symplectic manifold, the Hofer-Zehnder capacity is finite. right? Then, for any Hamiltonian, right, almost every regular energy level which is compact and bounds a compact set, right, in the complement of the boundary, carries a periodic orbit. So when I say carries a periodic orbit, I mean of the Hamiltonian vector field defined by omega of dot xh equals dh, right? Hamilton's equation. So what does...
Instead of that weird condition of being compact and bounding compact, if you just say h is proper bounded below, then...
If you want to take out... I would need to take out the boundary so that it becomes non-compact in order to say that the regular level set does not intersect the boundary, right? So, I mean, I would have to say some words. Yeah. The idea is that you have your manifold, you have inside that regular energy level, and for almost all of them, right, you can find a periodic orbit. And the way this goes is that look at the energy level, look at the small neighborhood, right? You foliate it by some other energy levels, and you know that the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of that thing is finite because it sits inside something that has finite capacity, right? And now, as soon as you are in a color neighborhood of your regular energy level, you can build up some very specific Hamiltonians, which will
by so geodesic flow with the Hamiltonian scales.
Sorry.
Almost every, don't you need the Hamiltonian to actually change values? So suppose it were like the geodesic flow, you're not going to produce periodic orbits in general.
Well.
I'm asking if the Hamiltonian has a property that is quadratic, so that there's a scale in it.
Yes.
Then how do you get to almost every? All right, can you prove with this theorem?
Yes. Well. Almost.
I take the geodesic flow on a complex manifold. I want to find periodic orbits.
Right. We do not specify the period of those orbits here. We're just. I mean, you know, if I specify the energy level, I mean the parametrization is not. I could just as well have phrased the result in terms of give yourself a hypersurface, right? In the neighborhood, you're going to find some periodic orbit.
That's all. I'm just worried that it's
yeah,
like
I'm allowed.
Yeah,
I mean,
the surfaces change.
Yeah, if I multiply the Hamiltonian with some large constant, of course the regular energy levels are going to be the same. So
it's rather a statement about the surface. It's not actually the Hamiltonian.
Yes, the Hamiltonian is not there somehow.
Okay.
I just phrased it in this way.
Sorry, you have to change the level space.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, and now why such a theorem, what's the intuition why such a theorem could possibly hold? Well, that comes from the very definition of the capacity. Right? This is a dynamical definition. Yeah? And the way it goes is that you consider some class of Hamiltonians, which are those that take non-negative values, right? Which have the property that they attain their maximum outside some compact set, which does not touch the boundary. So in particular, if I have boundary, I want it to be just flat equal to the maximum near the boundary, and then h is required to be 0 on some open set. Yeah. So the picture would be something like this. if this would be the boundary, and this would be the maximum of our Hamiltonian, and zero here. And inside here, we look at, let's call them admissible ones, or slow ones, which are those Hamiltonians such that all their periodic orbits are either constant or have large period. And large here, we just normalize by saying that period bigger than 1. Inside here, we could even define, and sometimes one does, and it's going to play some role in the talk, some subclass here, which lies in the middle, which consists of those Hamiltonians such that they satisfy exactly the same condition, but only for contractible periodic orbits. So there are those Hamiltonians for which all the contractible periodic orbits are either constant or have period large. And the Hofer-Zehnder capacity is the supremum over all such maximal values so that H is admissible. So
all periodic orbits are either what?
Constant. Or, sorry, have period bigger than 1. Yeah? And if I put a 0 here, right, it would mean lying in that class. So what does that mean? It means that whenever I take a Hamiltonian which reaches a value, right, such a Hamiltonian whose maximal value is bigger than this number, supposing this number is finite, right, automatically it's going to have a non-constant periodic orbit. And the way it is detected as being non-constant is that it's neither constant nor it has period bigger than 1. It has period strictly between 0 and 1. Right? So that's a mechanism of detection. Yeah. So in view of that existence theorem, of course we are interested in asking, in answering, rather, the following question: how to prove that the Hofer-Zehnder capacity is finite? And there is one remarkable tool, the first one, maybe historically, which is a so-called energy capacity inequality. Which says the following: assume your favorite manifold for which you want to compute the capacity lies inside a bigger one with some condition on the bigger one. You want it to be tame. Either it is closed, and if it's not closed or compact, you want it to have some control geometry at infinity. Right? Then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of the smaller thing is finite if the smaller thing is displaceable inside the bigger thing. If there exists phi compactly supported, right, such that phi w intersected w is empty set. Right? And we say that W is displaceable or Hamiltonianly displaceable in V. So this is a statement that is also quantitative in nature. Actually, one has some inequality between the Hofer-Zehnder capacity and what is called the displacement energy, which involves the Hofer norm. And it was first proved maybe for V equals R to N by Hofer-Zehnder, and then lots of people contributed, and probably the strongest form of this was proved by Schlenk after many and then some other refinements. Okay. So this automatically will give us some tools in order to address the question of when is the capacity of the unit cotangent bundle finite. I'll talk about this in a second. But let me just point out that what this says in particular is that displaceability provides you with periodic orbits. And this is something that we encounter over and over in symplectic topology. Whenever something is displaceable, it forces the appearance of some periodic orbits. And this is a kind of train of thought that has been emerging over and over in the field. Yeah? So here are some examples of how one can apply this. Assume you have L, some closed manifold, right, which has a Lagrange embedding in R to N, right? Then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of the unit cotangent bundle with the standard symplectic form is finite. And this is a consequence of the Weinstein neighborhood theorem, which tells us that if L is Lagrangian inside something, then a small neighborhood of its unit of the zero section in the cotangent bundle embeds in there as well. So it's a normal full theorem in the neighborhood of Lagrange embeddings. Yeah? So that's very good. Here's another example. Now, maybe it's hard to decide whether, and this is one of the outstanding problems in symplectic topology, which manifolds embed Lagrange embeddings into which. Yeah? But if you're not so much concerned about topology, you take any closed manifold, right? And then one sees that the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of the unit cotangent bundle of Q cross S1, right, is finite. Indeed, Q cross S1 admits a Lagrange embedding into cotangent bundle of Q cross, let's not take cotangent bundle of S1, but let's just embed the circle inside R2, right? And if that thing is embedded into something times R2, it's certainly displaceable out of itself. Yeah. So this is very good. But still leaves us with a general question, which is whether the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of the unit cotangent bundle is finite for all closed L. And I don't know, perhaps. And the answer is this is an open in full generality. Well, we don't know any example, or at least I don't, but some of my collaborators, which are much more experienced in capacities than I am, don't know examples of any such. So, and I will provide some partial results, and we can have a discussion. There's some interesting things going on. But note, for comparison, that this is certainly not true for the capacity which I decorated with zero, like in the component of contractible loops. Yeah? So if L admits a metric with non-positive sectional curvature, then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity in the component of contractible loops is infinite. Yeah? And this is simply because the geodesic flow has no non-constant contractible orbits. Yeah? And now I would like to explain some partial results towards this question. So perhaps a legitimate question is, why do we care particularly about cotangent bundles? And the answer is that these are really the archetypal symplectic manifolds, at least from a dynamical point of view, right? I mean, phase spaces are certainly the most important symplectic manifolds for Hamiltonian dynamics. So partial results towards this question. And I want to start with the theorem of Irie, which is the following. You take M to be closed oriented, right? We consider a component, a non-trivial component of the free loop space. So my decoration here means that I consider free loops, meaning maps from the circle to M, which lie in some free homotopy component, free homotopy class, which is not the class of constant loops. Yeah? Space of M. And assume that the evaluation, the evaluation map to M, which takes a loop to its starting point, has a section. Then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity is finite. And as examples in which this can be applied, for example, one could take, say, M to be Q times S1, as before. This is certainly good if we take the component of point times S1. Yeah. And more generally, if M carries some S1 action with non-contractible orbits, this is also good, right? This is also good. Now, I will say exactly two words here about the proof, namely that one infers some consequence about Hamiltonian dynamics out of some assumption on the free loop space. What is used here is the Chess-Sullivan loop product on free loop space. And as a matter of fact, the next two results that I will state, although they do not obviously put into the assumptions the free loop space, also rely in their proofs on the topology of the free loop space. Yeah, and this is something, some of the messages of this talk, that the best things that we can do on cotangent bundles involve, in some way or another, the free loop space. So here is a second result. Which is the one that triggered this talk. So let's take M to be closed now. And let's denote G by one of M. And denote F from M to BG, right? The classifying map for the universal cover. And assume that one of the following holds. The first condition, so our assumption is going to be phrased in terms of this map. So the first condition is the following. There exists a prime such that the map induced in cohomology in degree 2 with ZL coefficients is not surjective. Turns out that it's always injective, so that's the same as asking that it's not an isomorphism. Yeah. Or, second, there exists a prime such that the map induced in degree 3 is not injective. Then the conclusion is the same. The Hofer-Zehnder capacity, but now we can be even a little bit stronger. The one that takes into account contractible orbits is finite. And note that, of course, the Hofer-Zehnder capacity that takes into account only the contractible orbits is bigger than the Hofer-Zehnder capacity, which takes into account all of them. So in particular, we get that this one is finite as well. So this looks a little bit scary, but there's actually lots and lots of examples. And the best way to see examples is the following, is to notice that condition 1 is equivalent to condition 1 prime, which is that the Hurevich map from pi 2 to h 2 with integer coefficients is non-zero. Yeah. So the reason why these two are equivalent is the so-called Hopf exact sequence, which describes for us exactly the co-kernel of this map. So Hopf understood the fact that the co-kernel of this map is exactly the second homology group of the fundamental group with integer coefficients, right? And this is the classifying map here, right? So now you see, this being non-zero, right, is the same as this map being not an isomorphism. It's already an isomorphism at the level of H1. So that's essentially the same as this not being an isomorphism with some coefficients, okay? But now, out of a sudden, this seems very geometric. And in particular, any simply connected manifold, manifold with H2 non-zero is okay, right? For this. Strangely, any simply connected symplectic manifold would be fine. Well, maybe I'll keep this. But one can of course provide examples, even very non-simply connected ones, right? So other examples, take complex blow up, right? Of any closed manifold of even dimension, at least 4, right? I mean, you do complex blow up, immediately there are some spherical classes appearing there. So, and here you can take any kind of fundamental group, and you can even get non-finitely generated higher homotopy groups. For example, if you take T4 blown up at a point, pi2 is not finitely generated. Finitely generated. Right. So you can make weird things. Regarding condition 2, of course, the easiest way to cook up examples is by building manifolds that have vanishing H3, but maybe fundamental group with non-vanishing H3. And of course, this can be built. I mean, in higher dimensions, at least 6, you start with some connected sum of S1 cross some other sphere, and then you kill the homotopy, the generators in such a way so that you can produce any fundamental group and don't change the H3, which was 0, and so on. So there are. Yes?
Are there examples of cotangents with infinite capacity that are?
No, I don't know. That I think I said it. Okay. And if I have not, I should have, right? So there are cotangent, there are examples where the capacity that takes into account just contractible orbits is infinite, right? If you take manifolds with negative sectional curvature, yeah? But other than that, for the full Hofer-Zehnder capacity, we don't know. That's one question. Okay. So now comes maybe a third result. Oh, and you know what we are using from the abstract of the talk. So here we use local systems on the free loop space. And perhaps I will have time towards the end of the talk to explain that these conditions are exactly cooked up, are exactly the conditions that guarantee the existence of a non-trivial local system, yeah, with holonomy in Z mod L, yeah, and with fiber C on the component of contractible loops in the free loop space. Yeah? And for some reason, as soon as we have such a non-trivial local system, we can infer that the capacity is finite via the link between loop spaces and Fleur homology. Okay? But let me go to the, before explaining that, let me go to the third result due to Frauenfelder and Khajitnov. That's even more recent. And what they prove is the following. You take now M to be closed, right, and oriented. And again, we look at the fundamental group. F is the classifying map. For the universal cover, right? And we assume that when we look at the image under this classifying map of the fundamental class of M, we get 0 in the end homology group with rational coefficients. And this is what a concept that had been introduced by Gromov a long time ago in the 80s, and that's what Gromov calls Q inessential.
So which paper is
that? Filling Riemannian manifolds. Yes. And the conclusion is that the Hofer-Zehnder capacity in the component of contractible loops is finite. So now, here the examples are maybe even more striking, because all simply connected manifolds, all simply connected manifolds fall manifolds, but even all manifolds with finite fundamental group, right? Finite fundamental group. As a matter of fact, once you have proved something for simply connected manifolds, all finite quotients of those also will have finite capacity. It turns out that here, any finite group is also Q-acyclic, so you don't care so much. The assumption is also verified, but still. And also, by passing to finite covers, one is also able to say something about unorientable manifolds in this case. And as a matter of proof, it's again the free loop space, but what they use is localization, what's called Goodwillie localization. Localization for the free loop space, which tells us that if we look at the equivariant homology of BG, say with Q coefficients, we have a map induced onto the equivariant homology of LM, and that's F star, LM with rational coefficients. And this map is an isomorphism as soon as we localize at U. And when I say we localize at U, I mean that equivariant cohomology carries the structure of Q of U module, right, from the cohomology of CP infinity. And we, if we invert all the powers of U, this becomes an isomorphism. So again, the free loop space is there. And I would like to just emphasize the fact that both the assumptions here and the assumptions here are phrased in terms of this classifying map. And there seems to be, the fundamental group seems to play some important role there. And as another observation, we see that manifolds which are k pi 1s definitely fall outside the scope of both these theorems, right? So maybe in order to pin down something, we would like to understand whether the Hofer-Zehnder capacity of the cotangent bundle of a higher genus Riemann surface is finite or not. What about that? Now, of course, if we want to infer something about Hamiltonian dynamics using homological methods, we need to connect to Fleur homology. And so the relationship between symplectic topology of cotangent bundle and the topology of free loop spaces. Is provided at least one such relation, but in this context, by the so-called Viterbo isomorphism, maybe it's a little bit too small, I will. Yes.
G surface.
Yes.
With periodic orbits are usually easy to come by Hamiltonian mechanics because of the topology.
Yes.
That's where you learn about this capacity. This thing's upside down.
Yes.
But you could try to make very clever Hamiltonians.
Yes. No, I agree. I agree. You know, I made exactly the same reflection like when I was preparing this talk and came back after a year to this topic. You know, it's very strange, yes. It may be that by cleverly putting together all these and maybe making some nice construction, one can just conclude.
Yeah, but your theoretic problem is maybe misleading.
Yeah, very special.
You could giving the topology
yes.
have very long stretch things which wind around and so on.
Yes.
It really feels out.
Yeah. So my intuition is just about geodesic.
Well, mine as well, but okay, so let me state the theorem there. So it started with Viterbo, maybe in 1994. But then there were several alternative approaches. Salomon Weber, and then Abbondandolo Schwarz. And maybe the most complete one is Abu Zaid. And I think I should mention here also Chilibak and Lachev, which have influenced with their perspective. Yeah, but it's a longish story because Abu Zaid is 2013. Yeah? And the statement is the following. There exists, so M is closed here. There exists a local system on the space of free loops on the cotangent bundle, yeah, which restricts to the orientation local system. On M, which I view as constant loops in there. The fiber is Z. And the holonomy is in Z2. Yeah?
Orientation of the system on M or T star M?
Well, it's the same, right? Well, I want to write M. I want to view M inside T star M as zero section, which lies as constant loops inside LT star F. Yeah. Such that a variant of Fleur homology. It's not. I agree. On M. I want to say, sorry. Indeed, it's not the same. The orientation local system on M. Yes, T star M is orientable. So let's, no, on M. So symplectic homology of the cotangent bundle with coefficients in any local system twisted by this is the same as the homology of the free loop space Lm, right, for any local system. L on L T star M. Yes? So this symplectic homology is a variant of Fleur homology. And one can safely think of it as being Morse homology for the Hamiltonian action functional, for the Hamiltonian H, which generates the geodesic flow for some Riemannian metric. Yeah? And at least at the level of generators, the critical points of these are in one-to-one correspondence with the critical points of the energy functional here, which are closed geodesics. And actually, this is the deep reason why we have this isomorphism, because Fleur trajectories and the differential in the Fleur complex faithfully recovers the differential in the Morse complex for the energy action functional. And the presence of this additional local system which twists is just a matter of conventions on how things are oriented and how signs are assigned on one side or the other. Yeah. But of course, this is just one of the links. Yeah. Another one is provided by a theorem of Irie. It's the same paper, and I just rephrase it as compared to the original paper. So if ever there's no mistake, but I just refer to them. So if the map from the homology of M there's a map from the homology of M to the symplectic homology in the component of constant loops, contractible loops, is not injective, right? For some local system, L, on the component of contractible loops, then the Hofer-Zehnder capacity, which takes into account just contractible orbits, is fine. Yeah. So, Irie doesn't state it with local systems. It's fine. You can see that we do have such a map, at least via this isomorphism. If I want to just keep here some given local system, it's enough to tensor everything with that eta. And on the component of on the constant loops, I just get the orientation local system here. Local system. Yeah. And the way one has to interpret this is the following. We have the differential topology, say, of M. Yeah. If we used, imagine for a second that we used just constant coefficients on constant loops here, right? The homology of M would inject inside the homology of the free loops, right? So normally this map wants to be injective in there, right? If it is not injective, it means something has happened, and the thing over here that can kill an element here can only correspond to some non-constant periodic orbit, right? Because that's how it is, right? It's designed to be that way. So the principle is I compare the topology of M with what happens inside when I view M inside the free loop space. And if ever the topology changes drastically, if ever this map is no more injective, it means I have an object that will be homologically visible, right, in Fleur homology. And that object, that class, is going to allow me to see those non-constant periodic orbits for the Hofer-Zehnder capacity. This is the intuition behind. OK. So now we of course come to the question of how can we ensure that such a map is not injective. Yeah? So from now on, I focus on local systems, but the same idea, like comparing the topology of M with what happens when we view it inside the free loop space, is really at the basis of Irie's statement and also of the Fraunfelder and Pajitnov. So the best, the easiest way to ensure such a situation is to find a local system on L, on L0M, such that the homology of L0M with coefficients in L is 0, and L restricts to O, so that the homology of M with coefficients in O is constant. So that the homology with coefficients in O is the same as the cohomology of M and is non-zero. And if we manage to find such a local system which kills entirely the homology of the free loop space but still leaves this one unchanged, we are done. This is exactly, I mean contractible loop. Whenever I decorate with a zero, I mean contractible loop. So now, the key is the following observation, which we learned from Zeidel for M equals CP2. Yeah. And the observation is the following. If L is a non-trivial local system with fiber C, on the component of contractible loops in based loops, right? Then the homology is entirely zero. Fiber C or some field, or any other field for that matter. So this should be a little bit surprising, right? Because if we use constant coefficients, the homology of the base loop space is non-zero in infinitely many degrees. Yeah? And here we're saying that we can kill it entirely. Right? Of course, such a thing cannot happen by degree computation. And what we use in the proof is the fact that based loops form an H space, right? So that's a space that's multiplicative up to homotopy. So there is this multiplication. Right, which is given by concatenation of loops. Of loops, right? Yeah. Now, the fact that we have, so we can imagine this as a kind of monoid up to homotopy, right? And now, whenever we have such a such an H space, and whenever we have a local system of rank 1, right? So when we say local system, we mean local system of modules over some ring. Yeah? And if the ring happens to be a field and the fibers of the local system have rank 1, we have a ring structure. Ring structure, right? On the homology of base loops with coefficients in L. Yeah? For any local system of K modules of rank 1. And how does that go? Well, we take chains on the base loops with local coefficients, right? And there is a well-known map which sends us to chains on the product. And if we use local coefficients, it will send us to chains on the product, but with coefficients in the pullback local system, right? But now, so it happens that if we have the structure of an H space, right, this local system here is the same as pulling back L via multiplication. And this expresses the same fact, the same geometric content as the fact that for H spaces, the fundamental group is commutative, right? Multiplying, taking two loops and then multiplying them together is the same as taking their concatenation. Right? This is what this expresses. And because now I have multiplication, I can map two chains on L here, like that. That's a general fact. And this induces a ring structure on the homology. And of course, the unit is represented by the constant loop. Constant loop, say, at base point. And now what does it mean that L is non-trivial? It means that if I consider the base point and I consider a loop of loops, right? So we should imagine that this is like this, right? So this is a one chain inside the base loop space. I see that, so this gamma from the interval to base loops is such that the holonomy of gamma is non-zero, not the identity. What we see is that the differential of this gamma is this constant loop times 1 minus the holonomy. But the holonomy is not equal to 1, so this is some invertible element. And so the unit is a boundary. And this is the geometric picture. I've got a point, I've got that. And because the system is twisted, the unit is a boundary. And that does it. The homology vanishes. And the only thing I still need to write, and with that I will stop, is that local systems on L0M with holonomy Z mod L and fiber C, yeah, are in bijective correspondence with H upper 2 of the universal cover with ZL coefficients, and we take the invariant part under action of pi 1. And that's because with holonomy here, right, and which are constant on M. Constant on M. That's because homotopically the free loop space is like the product between constant loops and the base loop space. Actually, it's a twisted product. The fundamental group acts on the base loop space. That's that action. This condition of being invariant under the action of the fundamental group is having a local system on base loops which extends to free loops. And in turn, non-triviality of this is equivalent to the conditions 1 and 2 in the assumption of the theorem via the so-called Cartan-Leray spectral sequence. So there's a little bit of gymnastics in order to analyze this group. You end up with those conditions. And I end my talk.